just a little bit about what we're up to today. First of all, although I'm sitting here between two elected officials, I'm not anything remotely like that. I'm actually a consultant. My name's Jarrett Walker. I am a consulting expert in public transit planning and policy. I wrote a book called Human Transit. And I've been working with PAG, with the Pima Association of Governments, and with SunTran and city staff on essentially this process of visioning that we've done a little piece of now and that we're here to report out on. This is an opportunity to brief the elected officials in the room, their staffs representing them, but also to start potentially a larger conversation in the community about what you want transit to be and how public transit may need to change as your city grows. The agenda, very briefly, it's currently 9:30. I'm going to talk for a little more than half an hour, and what I'll be doing is basically explaining what we know now, and also explaining the outcomes of the staff workshop, the stakeholder workshop that we did, the visioning workshop, and sort of giving us all a sense of where that stands and to stimulate some discussion about where that might go from here. We'll be taking questions from the table as I can take questions from the table as we go, but if it's not a question you think is that everybody's having, then you might want to just leave it, and then I'll finish talking at about a little after 10. There'll be time for some discussion at the table, and then by about 10:45 or so, I'm going to be trying to move over to comment cards from the audience, and people from the audience commenting will have filled out comment cards. Everyone, I think they're right outside. And then we'll see where we are. If I have lots and lots of questions, I may find it easier to just read them off the cards and talk about them. If we have time, I'll ask you to come up and speak about them. And are we asking them to come to the podium? It looks like the podium's been moved.
Can move it back when
okay.
We need it.
Okay, so we'll put the podium back in that gap between tables, and you can come up and present your questions and comments there. It's great to have such a big audience. It's also great to have as much elected representation as we have and from some of the key communities around the region. That's great. That's how this conversation will begin. So let me just present for a little more than half an hour, and then we'll plunge in. So what we were asked to do and what we did on April 25th was to facilitate a workshop in which a number of key representatives from various segments of the community were invited to come together and do a bit of an exercise in visualizing the future of their transit system. And it was not a specifically budget-constrained exercise. It was more of a big-picture exercise. And we were talking particularly about 10 years. What do you want your transit system to look like in about 10 years? Now, I want to say a couple things that aren't in my presentation, but that I just want to emphasize really briefly. In 10 years, the city will be larger, and in particular, the core part of the city is expected to be denser. One of the things that happens as cities get denser is that demand for public transit not only grows faster than population, but it also tends to grow more diverse. And so, if some people in Tucson currently have the impression that people now riding the bus system belong to just certain demographic categories or certain categories of income, that becomes less true as cities get denser. And obviously, at the extreme, if you're in a place like Manhattan and you get on the bus, you'll see almost the entire diversity of that community, huge range of incomes, huge range of purposes and so on, all finding the same service useful. Thank you for the reminder. We'll ask people to turn their cell phone ringers off, and I have just done that myself. So one of the things I need to ask you all to be aware of as you're moving forward is that transit is something that changes very radically as you move through certain thresholds of density. And then the other thing we know, of course, is that densification is coming to some extent anyway because the free market is demanding it, right? If people didn't want to live at high density, then higher density cities would not be so fantastically expensive to live in, right? So the free market is telling us that whatever your personal tastes may be, there is a great demand for greater density, and that if you're going to attract your share of the 21st century economy, you're going to have to be responding to what the market is telling us people want in the way of housing supply and lifestyle and so on. And the streetcar was obviously a very important first move in the direction of facilitating that. But what we're here to talk about today is more on the context of, okay, now we have the streetcar, it goes from here to here, but what does the whole transit network for the city need to look like in order to really deliver those outcomes? At the same time, of course, we have a lot of issues associated with social inclusion and economic opportunity where transit is a crucial issue. Transit is a crucial access to jobs, access to opportunity tool. And if you want everyone in the community to believe that low-income people have the opportunity to become higher-income people, you have to provide that access to opportunity. And I guess the third thing I'd want to emphasize is that we have some larger cultural changes going on in the society around attitudes toward driving. Most obviously, I'm sure most of you have seen this curve, the history of the volumes of driving in the United States since the 1960s, it has gone like this. In 2004, it turned and went like this, and it's been going like that since then. So fundamentally, the assumption that we will always be driving more, we will always need to widen more roads and have more freeways because there's always going to be more traffic, is no longer true. It hasn't been true for about 10 years. And that's telling us that there's something pretty fundamental about some about priorities that may need to be updated to reflect that reality. So I'm going to sound a bit like a transit advocate here. Inevitably, I'm a transit professional. People tend to work in things they support. But I do want to lay out some reasons why typical attitudes toward transit that might have been formed in Tucson based on the system you see now may not be a good description of what the transit demand is going to be even 10 years out. And there's some, and we because my job is to go around to lots of different cities and work with different cities who are to some extent in different path stages on the same path, we know a lot about where this path goes and about what tends to come up for you politically as transit demand increases, and that transit demand is going to increase as density increases. It always does. And it may also increase for other reasons, like larger cultural changes about attitudes toward driving. One of the biggest cultural changes, let's remember, is this. It used to be that your commute time was wasted time. Now, a driver's commute time is wasted time, or it should be. They should not be looking at this, right? And so one of the main reasons, a new reason to use transit instead of driving is so that you can keep working. And this is one of the main reasons that I find that I will frequently take transit when it takes 50% longer than driving, because it's actually a better use of my time, and my time's very valuable. So think of that as another reason why, you know, currently prevailing attitudes about who uses transit may start to change, and people may, and people may, a much more diverse range of people may start wanting a transit alternative. And that's really some of the background of why I think it's important to be having this conversation then. I apologize. Karen, did you want to make any opening remarks? I was going to defer to you if you wanted to do that.
I do also want to welcome everyone and thank you. I know that many people in this room invest considerable amounts of time on these questions and how best to shape the future of our region. Mm-hmm. And I think this is a fundamental question facing us, and that we are at the pivotal moment to be able to influence how we move forward together as a region. And so I think the timing of this process and everybody's involvement is going to be time well spent. And I will work very hard with colleagues. I was very pleased to meet and look forward to working with Mayor Rojas from South Tucson and all of the colleagues throughout the region, the county, colleagues on the council and other towns and communities to make what we come up with together real as we move forward. So thank you.
Thanks. Did anyone else want to make opening comments or apart from? Okay, good. Welcome, everyone. So this workshop that we did on April 25th was just a first step toward that. It was just an icebreaker. It was a let's get into it. Let's start thinking about it. Let's start exploring what transit advocates at least agree or disagree on. I want to emphasize the extraordinary number of organizations that were that participated or were represented in the workshop in some way. quite a diversity of groups that you would expect to have quite a diversity of different kinds of interest in public transit coming together. We also had had some good elected representation. Representative Steve Farley was there. We had a number of other people indicating a high level of interest in the topic. And again, a diversity, a real diversity of points of view, everything from the real estate industry through to organizations like the Bus Riders Union to a range of other organizations that have to care about transit in order to do what they care about. We started by presenting some of the key existing conditions, and I'll just run through these very quickly. These are some useful maps. So, and I'm sorry, this should say before February 2015. This is what the network looked like before February 2015, which is when service reductions began to be made in the context of the city of Tucson's budget. And at that time, I want to call your attention to what these colors mean, because these colors will mean the same thing all through my presentation. So whenever you see a red line on any of our maps, that means service coming every 15 minutes or better all day. In other words, that means a basic sensation that the next bus is always coming soon. And that frequency tends to correlate with a fundamental sensation of relative liberty and opportunity and spontaneity. You're not going to wait a long time. And that's why what we're finding in the industry is that 15-minute service is just fundamentally, qualitatively different from, say, 30-minute service, where you begin to plan your life around the bus schedule. Another important thing to remember about 15-minute service is that where red lines cross, it's easy to make a connection. So that's actually like two roads crossing, and you can turn, because it's easy to get off one bus and on the other because the next bus is coming soon. On this map where you see two blue lines crossing, blue means every 30-minute service, they appear to cross on the map, but that doesn't mean you can actually connect easily because the waiting time is going to be very long. This is a fundamental thing to get about how transit is different from roads, because often people look at transit maps as though they're road maps and they think, oh, it looks all connected. No, it isn't unless it's connected in time. And the high frequency, the red lines, indicate the places where you have that high frequency in time. Now, unfortunately, we have had significant service changes that have affected this network just since we've begun working on this. So right now, as things stand, the frequencies on Campbell and 22nd Street have been turned down and are no longer every 15 minutes all day. Grant Road probably should never quite have been on here as a red line. It has 15-minute service for about 6 hours in the day. And there are also proposals to turn that down in the context of the city budget. We'll come back to the impacts of that. But looking at this network as the network that the ridership data was based on, I want to then look at the ridership. So this is a simple heat map of ridership by stop. You can see the blobs representing how many people are getting on the system at various points. What I want to do is go back and forth with my pointer for a minute. Let's look again at frequency, ridership. Frequency, ridership, and I want you to notice the relationship. So look at Alvernon, for example. Alvernon's a very interesting street. It's the longest crosstown, non-downtown, high-frequency route. Frequency, ridership. Okay, very obvious. Now, you can also see, for example, why it might have been 22nd that had its service turned down instead of Broadway or Speedway, because when they had comparable levels of service, the 22nd ridership was still lower. So there are some issues about 22nd. One of them is the extreme difficulty of getting across Aviation Parkway and through all of that route has to do. That is a bit of a barrier to that route being as successful as Broadway and Speedway are. So one of the conversations we'll be leading toward is, what do you really think the crucial frequent network corridors are, the corridors where we should never turn down frequency or make that the thing we would do as an absolute last resort? And after you talk about why that is, I want you to also notice there are sometimes cases where we have remarkably good ridership despite not very good frequency. So look at Euclid and North First. Frequency, it's only you see the red lines there on Oracle and Campbell. The line in between, Euclid First, is blue. It's not all that frequent. And yet, look at that. Really good ridership in the context of not really all that much frequency, that's a signal that that ought to be, that's probably a really high priority to turn up next time you have the opportunity, and that that route probably would support high-frequency service. Now, ridership, of course, isn't just a response to service. It's actually service in relation to the built environment. And by the built environment, I mean fundamentals about how many people are around at any particular stop, whether they can get to the stop, whether they're going to find the stop useful. So successful transit is always a combination of a certain kind of service in response to a certain kind of land use. So we have population density here. We have employment density. These are all pretty familiar. We also have this map, 2045 projected density, which is showing you essentially where extremely high density is anticipated of either housing or jobs. On this map, pink means residents, blue means jobs, purple, blue plus pink, means a mixture of the two, and darker means denser. We also use a gold cell to indicate places where both densities are extremely high. So you can see really clearly that kind of 4 to 6 square mile area now that combines the university and the downtown into one continuous big high density place. And also you see those substantial other pockets of major density around the city, which are going to need to be tied in to those places. And that becomes one of the crucial things that we look at in defining a transit network. So the participants in the workshop had access to this map. This was actually the base map that they were drawing on. So they were encouraged to think about 2045 density. Now, I want to make one other important point about 2045 density, which is that none of us really knows, right? 30 years in the future, all we can do is project. And projecting is not the same thing as predicting. Projecting is basically saying, based on what we know now, if nothing else changed and the political conversation didn't change and the market didn't change, here's what it would look like in 2045. We all know those are false assumptions. We all know that those things will happen. The reality is we just don't have a way of predicting. In other words, we're not very good at seeing around curves when we're talking about a nonlinear future. So that fundamental, what that means also is that if you made certain choices about transit, those would probably affect this map, because there are plenty of ways that development responds to transit, because, of course, people make individual location choices in response to transit, and they're ultimately the development's customer. So I want to come back to this basic recipe. If you want transit to have high ridership, which could mean, and you could want that for several reasons. You could want that because you want it to be touching more people's lives. You could want that because you want a lower subsidy per rider. You could want it for fiscal conservative reasons, essentially, wanting there to be less taxpayer money serving each rider. One way to do that is carry more people with the same money. And you could also want that for environmental reasons, because empty buses are not good for the environment. Full buses are good for the environment, right? It's only when the buses, not necessarily full, but when the buses are carrying enough people to displace enough cars, to justify, that's when transit is starting to deliver environmental outcomes. So the recipe for this is, I think, pretty well understood. And if you're curious, you can go into my book, Human Transit, where I really explain it geometrically. And I try to convey that we're certain about this the way we're certain about the value of pi, because it's about spatial geometry. It's about spatially how things work and spatially what things cost. The recipe, quite simply, is useful service following a favorable development pattern equals successful transit in terms of ridership. And you can see immediately, and so what I mean by useful service, what seems to constitute useful service is frequency, not a lot of waiting, a long span, enough duration that you're there for people when they need it. And that's an interesting point, because one of the ways that society is changing is that fewer and fewer people are commuting 9 to 5. And more people are traveling all over the clock. As work becomes more casual, work becomes more part-time, work becomes more self-directed, and so that weekend and evening span is an important thing. I'll come back to it. What's a favorable development pattern? This is really the nub of the political problem around transit, which is that everybody feels entitled to it, and everybody feels entitled to some, and yet if you design the transit system for ridership, you have to focus on, you have to think like a business. And a business chooses which markets it will enter and does not feel obliged to offer its services in places where it's not going to succeed. So one of the things I want to help people do is be very clear. And it's a very important, you know, for elected officials thinking about this, to be clear. This is what we would do if we were pursuing ridership. If I don't want you to do that, then I'm against pursuing ridership. I'm for something else, and that's okay. There are other purposes that transit is expected to serve. But one of the things I want to do is cultivate a clearer conversation that if transit were trying to maximize ridership, it would be focusing on places with a favorable development pattern. And a favorable development pattern has four basic elements. Density. Density, quite simply, is if I put down a transit stop, how much stuff is going on around it, right? How much stuff is going on within walking distance? How many people are coming and going to their homes? How many people are coming and going to work in the walking distance around that stop? That is what the word density fundamentally means. How much stuff in that fixed area. Second, walkability. It has to be possible to walk to a transit stop from that area. So in an area that presents high barriers to walkability, you're going to support a lower level of service, even if the land use density is exactly the same. Linearity. So your Walmart development down there is a good example of something that is huge in terms of employment, but it's not linear. It requires us to squiggle to go through it, to get close to it. So all other things being equal, what transit succeeds by being able to combine lots of different demand along one line and to just keep going straight. And where transit is allowed to do that by the street network, you get higher ridership. And so you can call it a bias. I'm simply saying if we're pursuing ridership, we're going to provide a lower level of service to places that require us to squiggle along. Because people don't want to ride through that, and we lose riders when we force people to ride through that. The final one is proximity. So I'll use the example of the casino out in the Southwest. If that casino were a few miles further east, closer to the city, but were exactly the same casino with the same number of jobs, it would support more transit service. Because it's expensive to go all that way. And if we didn't have to go as far, there would be more transit. It would be a better ridership prospect. So just remember, we're always dividing the market over the distance we have to go to get to it. And that's a fundamental. So that's really the recipe. We know how to design high ridership transit systems. I've been doing it for 20 years. We know what to do. The question is whether that's what you really want. Now that you see some of what that means in terms of focusing on some areas rather than others. And that's a question the region needs to debate. So let me quickly talk through what we did at the workshop. First of all, we played a game called Prairieville. Prairieville is a budget-constrained transit planning exercise for a fictional city. And the purpose of beginning with a fictional city is it allows participants to explore the tools and trade-offs for transit and get a little bit of experience working with the transit tool before they are thinking about their own interest group or before they're thinking about a city that they know. The point is, if you look at Prairieville, this fictional town called Prairieville, you're essentially having my experience of your city, which is, I don't live here, I don't know you know, who said what to whom, I don't know who's mad at whom, I don't know any of that the locals know. As a result, I often have a different sense of possibility, and we'll see the big city patterns that the locals may have trouble seeing because they know too much to see some of those patterns. So I wanted to give, Prairieville basically gives all participants that experience. Of being like a benevolent consulting firm, not knowing the details that would get in your way of trying to see the best network. So Prairieville is a simple city of about 300,000. This is its density map. Again, as always on our maps, pink is residential, blue is jobs, and darker means denser. So there's a big downtown in the middle. There's a dense medical center in the northwest. There's a dense university in the northeast. Those are the other two dark blue squares you see. And then there's some business park kind of and shopping mall kind of density that you see in the fainter blue. And you also see this concentric pattern of density. There's very clearly a historic dense town and it grows less dense as you go out. All the way out on the edges is sort of, you know, your mobile home with a well and septic on its own acre, that sort of density. The other important thing about Prairieville is that north is wealthier and south is less wealthy. It's designed to make it very easy for people to think about all those basic factors as they design a network. What we did then was to give them these playing pieces. They're actually little pieces of waxed colored string. And you had a red piece that went only so far, and that was a bus running every 15 minutes. And it's only that long because that's how long it would take for a bus to leave here, get over here, get back there, and be ready to go again 15 minutes later to deliver a 15-minute frequency. Of course, you can hook them together to create longer lines. There's also a piece of blue that's red every 30 minutes. They could trade in that piece of red for a piece of blue twice as long.
This is the basic math of transit. If I turn down the frequency, I've turned down the operating cost proportionally. If I've gotten longer, I've increased the operating cost proportionally. That's the fundamental math. And then finally, there was a 60-minute piece that was twice as long as that. So they could trade those in and decide whether they wanted like a smaller network of 15 or a larger network with a lot of 60. That is the ridership coverage trade-off right there to a great degree. So we got these six maps, and what I'm going to do is step through a few interesting things that happen. Because once we get these maps, the next thing that happens is that I talk with them and we start discussing what we can learn from the contrasts about between what different tables drew. So for example, if I just look at those two maps, one of the tables drew a network of frequent grids, frequent loops. They drew looping red lines concentrically orbiting around the city. And we pointed out that although you can see why, for example, a downtown neighborhood organization would like this, it connects them to themselves, it does create a problem, which is it's very difficult to get from a point on an inner loop to a point on an outer loop, because the loops never touch each other. So there are some fundamental problems with loops that we talked about, and they have to do with the way that all of the things being equal, transit is best if it goes in straight lines. That way, the frequent grid, which was the other example, those straight lines that intersect lots of other lines multiply the benefit of each line. So if I'm going along on this frequent line and I intersect another frequent line, that means this bus is now useful for going to all of those places. And so more people ride this bus because it's going to more places, more people are going to find it useful. That's the basic math. And that's why frequent grids are so powerful. Another contrast we had was, again, the ridership coverage trade-off. So I told you that if you have to decide how much you want the transit system to focus on maximizing ridership. And then, if you tell them not to, you need to stop complaining that their ridership is low, right? Because you've told them not to focus on that. That's fundamental. So transit agencies need to find, and you know, elected officials need to direct transit agencies about where they want what we call the ridership coverage balance. So the lower map here, you see a table chose to serve a very small area. As a result, they have only red and blue lines. They don't have a low-frequency service at all. But they're only serving the densest part of the city. And as a result, they're serving it really well. And that is actually probably the high ridership solution for the whole city, because we get our highest ridership by focusing good service where the land use is most favorable. The opposite extreme, the high coverage scenario, that table traded in their reds, their high frequency service for more low frequency service, and made sure they got to every corner of the city, right? So that's the network where everybody feels they're getting a little something. Unfortunately, it also means most people are getting hourly service, and it's just not that useful, and as a result, the overall ridership will be lower. That's called the ridership coverage trade-off. It's one of the most important policy decisions. I want you to notice when I present that decision that way, that there is no technical answer to this question. This is a trade-off between different values. And when you're making it, it's the sort of basically value judgment that's inherent in budgeting, where you're having to decide how important this is as opposed to that is. It is by definition the kind of decision that should go to elected officials and that should be the result of a community conversation and elected decision. I don't have an opinion about what anybody's ridership coverage split should be. All I know is that if you do make this decision and do have a clear policy about it, you'll get clearer outcomes that you can track back to your decision. And you'll understand why certain services have low ridership. Another interesting contrast was between the frequent grid, the grid pattern that you see on top, just north, south, and east, west red lines, and a more radial focus that tends to have more red lines converging on downtown. You're fortunate in Tucson because you can actually do both of these things pretty well, and you already do. Because this is something you have in common with my hometown, Portland, Oregon, by the way. Downtown's over on the west side against a bank of hills, and as a result, parallel lines, Speedway, Broadway, 22nd, can all come across, complete the grid, intersect all the north-south, and still converge on downtown. Still, there are diagonal destinations. So we're having a conversation now about Route 9, the East Grant Road line, whether that should ultimately continue to stair-step across the grid to go downtown, or whether at some point it should turn into a crosstown and just go back and forth Grant Road, forcing people to transfer at Oracle or Euclid or Campbell to go south. That sort of transition happens at a certain point when you decide that that everywhere-to-everywhere mobility is more important to you than just getting everyone downtown. And as the dense area of the city grows larger, the grid tends to make more sense. But we're always finding the right balance of these two. Downtown will always be important. We'll always have a level of convergence there. So I just want to come back on the genius of the frequent grid and why this is so powerful. And it's the foundation of a number of redesigns I've done, including most recently a redesign of the Houston network, which I encourage you to follow. It goes live in August. The genius of the frequent grid is that if you have this pattern of just red lines north, south, and east, west, then from absolutely any point A to absolutely any point B, I didn't pick these points because I get a particularly good answer. Close your eyes and stab at the map. It can be anywhere in the grid. The way you get there is exactly the same, and it works. You have a short walk, you have a short wait because the line is frequent, so you get on the bus quickly and you ride to a connection point. You connect to another bus, which is easy because the connecting bus is frequent. Again, the frequency is essential. And then you ride to near your destination and you walk to your destination. Those are the directions between absolutely any two points. So one of the interesting things about frequent grids is that they're egalitarian. We don't have to decide about winners and losers. We don't have to decide that this neighborhood's more important than that neighborhood. All those things that are immensely painful for elected boards to talk about, it just doesn't arise here to the extent that you're able to extend the frequent grid in this way. So after we did Prairieville, we did a Tucson network planning game. And so now that the participants had played with the tools, we invited them to think about Tucson's own geography. Now, what we said was think 10 years into the future. So be thinking about how you want things to change over the next 10 years. We also gave them a hypothetical budget, and I emphasize hypothetical. There is no financial plan behind this. What we were doing was giving them a budget sufficient that they could imagine what they might want to do, which might give them a reason to support having that kind of money, but not so much that people felt they didn't have to make hard choices and hard trade-offs. And 25% turns out to be a nice number for that purpose. These resources could be used either to upgrade lines to higher frequency as red lines. We had red pieces they could put down. Or they could use it to expand 30 or 60-minute service into other areas. That would be coverage, essentially, low ridership coverage services. Overwhelmingly, they chose the former. Overwhelmingly. And let's look at the details. Every group added new segments to the frequent network, and in almost all cases, these were upgrades to existing lines. We compiled all of the group's maps to identify the frequent network segments that they seem to be most interested in, and here is that map. Now, I need to caution you that we have a problem here because of the moving target of service cuts going on at the same time that we're doing this process. So the orange lines on that map are the places where service has been reduced within the past year or is proposed to be reduced within the next year. And those are all places where routes are proposed to be taken down below a 15-minute frequency, which means a red line is going to turn blue. It's going to drop out of the frequent network. And unfortunately, when we were doing the exercise, the base map that the participants had to work with showed those three lines, 22nd, Grant, and Campbell, as existing frequent lines, so they didn't have to think about whether they would want to pay to put them back now that they're no longer there as frequent lines. So that's one. So we have tended to assume that certainly 22nd and Campbell would likely be people's high priorities for frequent service, but we didn't test that in the workshop because we didn't ask that question. But nevertheless, apart from that, let's look at the rest of this. Every single table identified Euclid North First as the top priority for high frequency service. Every single table put a line there. That's interesting when you look back. So they know something that is also there in the ridership, because remember I pointed out when we looked at the ridership map that Euclid North First really jumps out at us as having a lot of ridership for not having very much service. That's low-hanging fruit. You can see the other things. Almost everyone wanted to go to PCC West. Although they differed slightly by which route you take to get there. And you can see some of the others. There was a lot of discussion about new north-south elements further east. Every table drew at least one of them. There were differences about the relative importance of Craycroft or Colb or some of the others. So you see it spread out. But everyone knew there needed to be another crosstown out there. In the south, one of the things we noticed was that the network designs that the tables were doing seem to be extremely oriented toward the airport. And this is one thing where I feel, where I had to make the judgment that I don't think our group in the workshop was representative enough of the South to feel that we could go by this. Yes. Because it's understandable that the one place in the South that all of Tucson is interested in is the airport.
Yes.
But that doesn't necessarily mean that that's what South Tucson, Southern Tucson needs, what that whole part of the city needs. Inevitably, our workshop was conducted in English. We had some representatives from that community, but I felt I had to intervene a little bit on this one, because the airport is important, but it's probably not this important at this stage, and we can talk more about that. So we also asked a question about high-capacity transit. Now, I want to emphasize, you can argue about whether streetcar extensions would be high-capacity transit, by which I mean extensions of the existing streetcar line. What we're talking about here when we use the term high-capacity transit is high-capacity and high-speed transit, suitable for going relatively long distances, which is not what the streetcar is, you know, given its speed. One of the main issues with the existing streetcar line is because it is, by design, not very fast, it is hard to extend very far, because the further you're going, the more of a problem that slowness is. And so we tend to take the view that while you may find some small expansions of the streetcar, and you may come up with new streetcar lines, if they're going to be useful for going longer distances, they have to be designed to be faster than the current streetcar. That's one of the basic trade-offs. So when we think about high-capacity transit, we're really talking about light rail or bus rapid transit, things that we associate with higher speed, still high frequency, but higher speed optimized over longer distances than what the streetcar is optimized for. That's really the trade-off. We asked the groups where they felt they should be the top priorities for high-capacity transit. Everybody agrees that there's basically a corridor to the east, which everyone agreed was Broadway. Then everyone agreed that there was a northern corridor, but they differed on whether it was Oracle or Euclid first. And everyone agreed that there was a southern corridor, but they differed on whether it was South 6th or Keno. That's fine, because that's all we need. Your next step with a high-capacity transit study would be to do what's called an alternatives analysis, which would study multiple corridors, and would be that would be the appropriate forum for opening the conversation about whether it's Oracle or Euclid first and how you would make that trade-off. That happens normally in those HCT studies. This is just enough direction to get you started, which is it looks like you have three HCT corridors to study, north, east, and south. And a couple people thought it should also go west to PCC West. Now, I mentioned coverage expansion. Only a couple of tables made any expansion to the coverage area. There was a very high focus on ridership in this workshop. I didn't tell them to do that. That was their choice. The coverage expansion areas that were suggested are the orange areas on this map, West River Road, and these areas to the far southeast. This is generally all along the south end of Houghton, going down to I-10. And the employment areas down there and so on. Those were the main expansion areas people were talking about, essentially wrapping all the way around the Air Force Base. But again, this was a low priority. We then polled the stakeholders out about a bunch of policy questions. Now that you've played with these tools, what do you think about the big picture questions that they imply? So this is the ridership coverage question. And what I did was to tell them that right now, as near as I can tell, about 80% of Tucson's transit service is where it would be if ridership were the goal of the design. And about 20% isn't. About 20% is predictably low ridership. We know you're going to get low ridership when you drive out there, so it has a non-ridership purpose, is what we're saying. And I asked them, you're now at 80-20. Would you move that one way or another? Where would you like that policy to be? 50% of the respondents wanted to push the policy even further toward ridership. Most of them chose 90-10, small number chose 100-0. So an overwhelming focus on ridership. Let me be absolutely clear what that means in policy and political terms. As you turn the dial toward ridership, you get higher ridership and you also get tremendous outrage from the parts of the city who are losing service in that situation. And so that's the whole picture that your elected leaders will ultimately have to grapple with. Turning the dial this way, ridership goes up, and people who lose service are really angry. Really, really angry. And if you're curious to read more about that, look up an article of mine called Houston System Reimagining, Don't Let Us Make It Look Easy. Because it wasn't easy. It wasn't easy for the elected officials. We took Houston through a process of shifting. They decided to shift from about a 60-40 split, only about 60% ridership, all the way up to an 80-20 split. That meant lots of low ridership routes disappeared, and lots of people were angry. And they understood that that was part of doing that, and they made that choice knowing that that was part of the cost, that they were going to have to deal with all of that anger and understand that. So that's part of the whole story here, very important part of it. A few people, not very many, wanted to actually turn the dial the other direction, toward more coverage services. But most people were either comfortable on the current split or wanted to move it further toward ridership. Resource level. So we'd given them this imaginary set of resources. Now that you've played with it, the question was, do you think that's a good amount? Do you think that's the right amount? Do you think that's how much the system should grow? The bottom two choices were, no, it should be less than today. We saying, fundamentally, we have too much transit service even now, let alone when we add all this service. The second option up was, no, it should be the same as today. In other words, I don't think we need this additional 25%. Nobody chose those options. Almost 50% said they thought 25% was reasonable for growth in 10 years. And you had you had the rest of them saying, no, it should be even greater than that. And there's plenty of peer experience with growing systems at various different rates. And obviously it depends a lot on how your city grows. High capacity transit. Given that we had asked people to think about a high capacity transit corridor, we also wanted to ask them how important it was to them to pursue a high capacity transit project, given that there are other things you can be doing with the same effort, like just building up your local bus system. Pretty strong enthusiasm. 50% strongly agree they want to chase a high capacity transit line in the next 10 years. Another 15% or so lightly agreed. Almost a quarter were actually negative about HCT, and that was mostly about fearing that that was going to take energy away from something else that was more important to them, like the local bus system. So based on the stakeholder outreach process and workshop, we were then asked to draft something that might look like a vision map. Now, I can't begin to tell you as a consultant how terrifying that assignment is, because the vision map has got to be yours. I'm leaving town. It's got to be yours. You have to like it. I don't have to like it. So all I'm really doing here is sketching something for you to start with, for you to start a thought process with. And it may be something you can work with for a while, but we also encourage you to do more of a long-range planning process that gets you to something that has a larger buy-in that many more people have touched and contributed to than what I'm going to show you right now. We evaluated the stakeholder game results. We also thought about land use, ridership data, and network design principles to sketch future changes in the transit network. We talked about three things: frequent network improvements, the frequent grid, high-capacity transit improvements, and also coverage expansion study areas. High-capacity transit, we are a little surer than the stakeholders are that the winning Southern line is probably 6th rather than Keno. But it doesn't really matter that much, because if you do an alternatives analysis for a Southern line, you'll study both of them anyway. You'll study multiple corridors that go that same general direction. And you'll study things that go on to the airport as opposed to just to Laos. So there are plenty of opportunities to open that up again. Other than that, we're largely endorsing what the stakeholders said, that you have a strong northern HCT corridor, which is somewhere between Oracle and Euclid First inclusive. A more detailed process would figure out where. And we're endorsing an eastern corridor. Now, one of the things you've got to keep in mind is that HCT, bus rapid transit or light rail, is really only very effective if it has an exclusive lane in congested areas. It's got to be able to get around traffic. So given that there's recently been a decision to not have an exclusive lane on Broadway, one of the ways you could react to that if you were doing an HCT study would be to open up the options of both Broadway and Speedway as streets you might want to study for HCT. But ultimately, that conversation will lead to a somewhat different conversation about what the long-term vision of those streets is. Because if ultimately you do want to do HCT, you're going to have to provide the space, you know, the appropriate provisions for buses to not get stuck in, for buses or light rail, to not get stuck in traffic. And again, short streetcar extensions could also be studied, but what we really mean by HCT here are the faster, longer distance, high volume connections that you need across the city. Network priorities frequent. So what's here, what's left in red on that map is what remains of the frequent network after the budget cuts that affected the network last year and this coming year. What is left is just Speedway, Broadway, Oracle, Alvernon, and the two southern routes, 6th and 12th. So as a result, where we had been working with a base map that had other frequent lines shown as existing, we've shown them on this map as probably priority one. So the way this map works is that the remaining frequent lines are red, and you can see you don't have much of a grid left. I mean, it's really been substantially reduced by these cuts. The dark green would be your top priority corridors for adding new frequent service. And those include all the corridors where it was just deleted. Then the various paler shades of blue down into turquoise are lower priority tiers for adding more service. So I wanted to emphasize the North Tucson grid is very simple. It's a very regular grid, and the space, you notice the spacing of routes is extremely consistent. The existing system, by the way, has more routes than this. It tends to have routes in between these in many cases. Those would over time come to be de-emphasized as these big routes would be emphasized, and over time people would walk further to the more useful service on the main grid. But again, I also want to emphasize we had to completely rethink the southern part of the city compared to what we came out of the stakeholder workshop. And we did that by looking at the land use patterns and the demands and concluding that Laos Transit Center and Irvington are the appropriate boundary point between a high frequency grid pattern and south of Irvington, a lower frequency pattern, which will continue to be then feeders into Laos, relying on the connections at Laos Transit Center. So that's why you see both Irvington and Ajo Way drawn in as new east-west high-frequency routes at various levels of priority, because ultimately southern Tucson can support this high frequency as far south as Irvington. South of there, it starts falling away. You start having more walkability barriers and so on. And that's why you see the various feeders, a high priority on the feeders to the airport and also going out Calle Santa Cruz to Walmart area. But a basic structure that's grid down to Irvington and node and feeder south of Irvington. Coverage, again, we just endorsed the stakeholder priorities, but these were all low priorities to the stakeholders. And so we tend to assume the vision is starting with the notion that expanding the coverage area is a low priority. I want to quickly mention weekend and evening issues, because we didn't really talk about this in the stakeholder workshop. I want to alert you that many cities are finding that if they serve weekends at the same level as weekdays, minus the peak rush hour, of course, they get comparable ridership. And it's showing up in transit agencies that are starting to see Saturday productivity higher than weekday. Again, in Houston, we're about to do a big experiment with this, and you should watch the results. So in Houston in August, the new network that's going in has Saturday and Sunday service levels set to exactly the same as weekday. Actually, the bus goes at exactly the same time 7 days a week. And we'll see what the effect of that is. But the suspicion is that weekend is actually an important area of low-hanging fruit for ridership growth, because the society is becoming more and more a 7-day and 18-hour culture. Weekend and evening demand reflects the relative expansion of the service, retail, and entertainment sector, and the shift in many employment and activity sectors toward flexible working arrangements that have people coming and going at all hours. You also have a giant university in the middle of your city, and universities have always been great engines of 18/7 demand, if not 24/7 demand. People are coming and going all the time. So that's an important other thing to think about. So our recommendations for policy action. I can't emphasize too strongly that this is not a long-range plan yet. It is a much more cursory effort. It's really the result of one excellent workshop where I think we got lots of good ideas out, but it's not enough of a conversation. We don't have enough involvement, and there's a larger process to do that. Concurrently, there is a 2045 regional transportation plan going on at PAG. That is all modes. That is roads and transit and other things, it will identify a 30-year, not 10-year like we just did, but 30-year high-capacity transit and frequent network. And anyone who's interested in that one should be involved in that process and should be contributing their thoughts to that process. That should be an even bigger network than the one we've drawn here. You'll also need, though, I mean, how many people can actually be interested in 30 years from now? 10 and 20 years are the, at 10 years especially, tends to be the long-term planning threshold that enough existing voters actually care about. And so the 10 and 20-year long-range plans, transit plan visions, but I would suggest especially the 10-year vision is a critical thing to have. You'll need a 10-year or 10 and 20-year long-range transit plan. That's not, that's different from the regional transportation plan. And to guide the key decisions in those timeframes, and also to control the linkages to other areas of policy. I can't emphasize too strongly that transit ridership is not just a result of transit service, it's a result of land use planning, parking policy, and street design. And those fundamental capabilities, which usually lie with municipal governments, are transit decisions. They are decisions about how much transit ridership you want and how effective you want transit to be. And so the extent to which those decisions get aligned is huge for how effective your public transit system is actually going to be. We now have some very interesting examples, like the San Francisco model of a municipal agency, of a municipal transportation agency that controls transit, traffic, and parking. And a transit planner is down the hall from a parking policy guy and a street designer, and that street designer is not going to inadvertently draw something that wrecks the bus service because the transit planner is two cubicles away, and we'll see it and we'll stop it. You know, there will be that conversation happens, and you and everything gets integrated very effectively. So that's another thing a long-range transit plan can explore your desire to do. It becomes a conversation with the municipal authorities about what kind of role they want to play. The other thing, then, a long-range transit plan would build a broader community interest by exploring transit's nexus with urban development, the needs of dependent populations, access to jobs and opportunity, and civic image and branding, which are some of the main things. But this is overall an important part of your, of Tucson's value proposition. If you want to attract jobs to the region, if you want to attract creative people to the region, if you want to attract people who grow economies. It would refine the network plan for the 10 and 20-year horizons. It would take that map we just drew you and make it much more specific and make it the result of a lot more people's input. Relevant jurisdictions would then be encouraged to adopt policies on the things they control, like land use and street design on the frequent network, and also about how long-term planning should affect short-term planning. So we've had this issue recently that we've done this long-term planning exercise at the same time that a short-term planning exercise was going on, which has given us this problem of these cuts are happening in the network at the same time we're trying to talk about it. And that's something that in future you would want to have more harmonized. In future, too, a municipal decision about its transit budget would be more informed by what that does to the, exactly what that does to the network, how that impacts people, and so on. So you'd have a more two-way conversation about budgetary decisions, because budget decisions are ultimately value judgments. And of course, it would also explore funding strategies for transit growth. If you wanted that 25% transit growth, you'll need some kind of new funding source, and it would explore places to look for that. Meanwhile, pending having that plan, there's some things you can still do. You can use the visioning priorities maps to inform transportation and land use planning about where to expect frequent transit service. I would encourage, if you're a municipality or if you're in, or if, and frankly, I would encourage you, if your organization makes location decisions about anything, to take that network vision map and put it up on your wall and look at it when you're making a location decision about anything. It's not just land use planning, remember. The other great thing about frequent networks is that below the level of actually what gets built is just where people choose to locate their specific residences and offices. And even in the context of the built environment not changing, when you begin advertising the frequent network, once the frequent network appears in SunTrans public presentation as a product that they are promoting, you start to get people who value transit locating on that network, people who value transit less locating away from that network, completely below the level of the development or urban form conversation. That's better for transit, because the transit agent lines, the best transit lines come to be lined with people and institutions that value them and will use them. And that's a key thing that frequent network branding does, a key reason to do it. And so it would also establish priorities for short-range planning tasks, such as COAs, comprehensive operational analyses, which you just did a year ago. It would form a starting point for any high-capacity transit network process. The federal government, if you're going to ask them for money for high-capacity transit, will look more favorably if you have a story about how that fits into a total network instead of just a story about one line. And we're increasingly finding that if you have to go to the voters will reward you for having a story about the total network and not just a story about one line you want to build. And then begin elected and community discussion about the ridership coverage trade-off, leading to some provisional direction. How important is it to you to have this set aside of low ridership, predictably low ridership service to get to people who really need it, or to make people in that part of the city who pay taxes to feel like they're getting their fair share. Those tend to be the two reasons you do that. How important is that, and how much do you want to set aside for that? Currently about 20%. Should it be less? Should it be more? That needs to be a larger conversation. So at this stage, those are all of my remarks, and I want to open it up to questions and discussions at the table, and then in about half an hour, I'll then open it up further, and we'll start collecting comment cards. And someone back there is collecting. Catherine, you've got the comment cards, or they're going to come to you. Okay, great. The question cards. Thanks. So, questions? Yes.
One of the things that we're working, the community, the city, and the county are working on is developing the area south of the airport. That's where the large there's large parcels, and that's where large employers we expect to locate. Finding major parcels in town where major employment will occur is diminishing. So one of the things I noted is you saw the future going out toward the Tech Park and the Houghton Corridor. That's where the current, there's acreage out there, there's the Port of Tucson, and that sort of thing. But in the next 5 to 10 years, we're positioning this area south of the airport as the next major employment center. So we're expanding the employment center that's already at the airport. There's 13,000 people working out there mm-hmm. now. So part of the thing I would like to see is as you look at this, you need to look at where the increase, where we expect growth to occur. And we need to start projecting those transit lines to address that. We've got Home Goods going in right now in South Algernon. That's 800 employees, and they're minimum wage plus. So those are going to be your heavy propensity riders. So we need to start planning to get down in that area.
This is a very important aspect of the ridership coverage trade-off, because I want to ask that question again. Do you want the transit system to be focused on places of high ridership, or do you want the transit system to respond to needs like the ones you've... It's fundamentally a demand versus need question. What you're talking about is the need for more coverage service, because low-density business parks with abundant parking are not high ridership destinations, ever. There's just not enough disincentive to driving. So that is an example of a land use plan that has the effect of increasing the demand for the coverage slice of pie. And that is an effect on then your conversation about the ridership coverage balance. Now, it depends entirely on the kind of employer. Information technology employers are starting to turn away from the business park and move back downtown. I'm seeing that very strongly on the West Coast. So don't be surprised if that starts to happen. And it's very generational. Facebook, Google, Apple, corporate business parks, Twitter, tower in San Francisco. And so, Uber, tower in San Francisco. And it's not just happening in San Francisco. There is going to be increasing demand, and you should be prepared for the moment when some big money wants to build a tall building downtown that will be extremely transit dependent, because that's a good land use pattern. So that's great, and you can add other coverage areas. Just be aware that you're talking about the ridership coverage trade-off when we talk about that.
I understand. Part of what we have to focus on.
Yeah, absolutely.
First of all, I just want to thank you, Jarrett, for your excellent work this last 12 months and helping our community think more clearly about transit. You've done an excellent job, and this really hopefully can be the beginning of a new conversation in this community. My question is really about going forward with implementation. As you may or may not know, the governing institution beyond the Association of Governments is the Regional Transportation Authority, enabled by the state legislature. It has limited scope, but that's what we're operating under. And it's basically driven by much more suburban values than urban values. And one of the tensions going on between smart suburban transportation planning and smart urban transportation planning are these differences. And what my question is, how would you consider us considering a regional transit authority to really bring this transit vision into full flowering with all the alt modes and the parking facilities as a separate thing, and leave the roads to another entity that's more interested in that? Because I think that in order for this, for what we've gone through this last 12 months with you, is going to require the real internalization and working these things out, because we're in an environment where widening roads and building transit cannot happen at the same time. We're just constrained like that. So regional transit authority, what's the prospect and the benefit of that?
That's a huge question. Let me just make, and I don't know what your governance arrangement should be, and I don't know that what you want is a regional transit authority. I don't know that. And the reason I don't know that is that although that has been the standard model in North America now for 50 years, some limitations of that model are cropping up, and some problems with that model are cropping up. And one of them is what you mentioned, which is that a regional transit authority across an enormous area ends up having trouble focusing on the real needs and ridership potential that lie in the dense urban core. That is inevitable. There's nothing, and I want to emphasize, I'm not criticizing anyone. If you have a representative board for a gigantic region, that urban core is going to be a minority on that board, however it's constituted. And you may find you have difficulty getting the consensus to do those inner city things. If you're
so
making
would you propose that we change the regional transportation authority's
just
charter
let me
for
just
proportional
talk.
Representation?
Let me just
you don't have proportional representation.
Okay, if you don't have proportional representation, that can be an issue. But the point is, there are several different emerging models for how transit can be organized. I don't know which one's right for you, but the regional transit authority is no longer the only one. So another thing that's happening is that, so I've mentioned one other model, which is strict municipal control that fuses within municipal government the transit function with the parking and traffic functions that are already in municipal government, so that those things get integrated that way. Each different governance structure combines certain things but separates other things, right? If we do the big regional transit authority that's separate from the municipalities, and I've worked in lots of these environments, then the danger is that the municipality doesn't feel ownership of the transit system and doesn't integrate it with its land use and street design well enough. So there's no easy answer. There are several different trade-offs. Another aspect of the trade-off is when we have municipalities that are in a big region, when you have municipalities that just really want to go at different speeds. So the phenomenon we're seeing in many regions now, I've just been through two examples in the state of Washington, Spokane and Seattle, where a giant regional transit agency over something the size of, not even the size of all of Pima County, but Pima County minus the rural west, went to the voters for a tax increment for transit failed by a narrow margin. And the precinct map of the vote was basically a map of residential density, right? It's very, very obvious, and when you see those results, it helps us realize, you know, nobody's doing anything wrong here. People are voting their daily experience, and it's completely understandable that if you live on a mobile home in a house on an acre with your own well and septic way out of town, you don't feel much transit need, because if you wanted to build your life around transit, you wouldn't have chosen to live out there. So it's understandable that the attitudes toward transit are different in different areas. And what I always try to do is say, let's not think about this as liberal or conservative or anything like that. Let's just think about this as people voting their own experience. And it's understandable that people who are in those parts of the region are unlikely to see transit as a priority. It's just not important in their lives. This goes to, you got to remember the underlying math here, which is that the importance of transit is overwhelmingly related to density, and it's non-linearly related to density, twice the density, more than twice the transit demand, which is why it's felt overwhelmingly in the core city. So what's just happened in both Seattle and Spokane is that we've had a no vote at the regional level on something. It's happened in Seattle. You had a no vote on a regional level, which was going to cause severe cutbacks in the dense core city, Seattle. The regional suburbs who voted no on this just thought, well, transit's not that important to us.
But in Seattle, transit was existential. Transit has their economy by the throat. They are so dense that they don't function without transit. And so it was a matter of absolute urgency for the city of Seattle to raise, to go to its own voters for its own funding increment. Now, the Tucson borders are a lot different. They include much more of the suburban area. But you, somehow or other, there has to, there, you know, I think we're increasingly going to be looking for the mechanism by which the core urban transit-dependent area has a way, has a legal way to raise money among the voters who actually care about that. And that's going to, what that's done in Seattle is to create now a two-tiered transit agency, where there's still the regional transit agency that runs all the service, but now there's a higher increment of service inside Seattle city boundaries that respond to their higher level of need. And I think we're going to see that happen more and more, frankly, because transit is becoming more polarizing as an issue, and so on. So I don't know the answer. What I know is that different governance models succeed at combining different things. It's easy to want a regional transit authority because then, you know, the city limits never get in the way of the transit design. That's good. That's integration in that dimension. But having transit at the municipal level means that the transit design is integrated with the parking and land use policy, and that's just huge in terms of how transit's actual outcomes. So there are lots of answers, and that's a good thing to be studying and talking
about. Again, thank you.
Suzanne.
Oh, okay. I'm Suzanne Schaefer. So as you know, we have a pretty large number of what we call express bus routes in our system, and obviously those are, you know, have a different ratio of resource use to productivity. But they also have a different funding system. And so in our current discussion, that where there's been a whole lot of focus on the sort of the crisis in the city budget, there's been less discussion. And I'm wondering if you could speak to the that whole commuter route piece and specifically how it relates to what we've been talking about in terms of resource use.
I'm not going to talk specifically about your commuter routes because I haven't studied them. Let me talk about just some basic issues about peak commute service in general. If it is part of the ridership network, if it is motivated by high ridership, it has to be even more productive than all-day service needs to be. And the reason for that is that there are particular costs, high costs, that come with peak period, peak-only service. There are basically three kinds of cost. One is that peak service is usually running in one direction, but the driver has to get back to the starting point, and you have to pay the driver to get back to the starting point usually, because shifts have to end where they began. I don't know a labor contract anywhere that lets somebody clock in somewhere and clock out somewhere else. The second thing is that peaking implies short shifts. You have to get up in the morning and go to work, and you're only going to work for 2 hours. Who's going to be willing to do that? So you have to pay those people more usually to put up with going to work for just 2 or 3 hours and then being off. And the third element, of course, is that the peak fleet drives how many buses the transit agency needs to own and store and maintain. So those are three kind of often hidden costs of peak service. Because if you just look at peak service with standard productivity measures like boardings per revenue hour, you don't see any of those factors. What that means is that frequently when we're doing ridership increasing redesigns, and I've done many of these, one of the things we often have to do is cut unproductive peak services. And that usually either means, sometimes it means replacing them with limited stop services, for example, that more people find useful. Sometimes it means eliminating them. Because one of the other realities we have is that as cities grow denser, the peak demand grows, but the midday demand grows faster. And so where peak routes have made sense because there wasn't much midday service, as the midday service comes up, sometimes that changes the value proposition of the peak route. So the thinking, so that's some of the considerations that will come up as you work through that. Any other questions from the table? Points of discussion? Anyone who disagree with me?
One.
Okay, Brian. Hey.
Bus writer, Brian Flagg. So a week ago, the city council, as part of their budget, chopped $1.1 million out of the transit budget. Part of those were like little modifications to routes, but the other part of them was cuts in frequency. Mm-hmm. And everything I read from your books, from your study, from sitting here right now listening to you, is that's a way to like lessen and make worse the bus system. So before the council, before the city enacts those things, those cuts, they're supposed to confer with you and also the transit task force. So could you weigh in on that, whether you think these probably $600,000 or something like that worth of cuts is wise for our bus system?
So let me say, just to be precise, nobody has asked my opinion on how big Tucson's transit budget should be. That's your community's value judgment. I have been asked to review some of the specific service changes, and I'm in the process of working with SunTran. But the context of that conversation is, if the budget is being cut this much, what is the least destructive thing to do in terms of how to take those cuts in the least destructive way? I have observed that, generally speaking, cutting frequencies from 15 to 20, as has already happened on Campbell and 22nd, is generally a kind of cut that to which ridership is very sensitive. And I would not be surprised to see ridership losses as a result of those cuts. It's a little different because 22nd hasn't been frequent for very long, and so it hasn't really built up as much of an expectation of high-frequency service. But I have observed that cutting services out of the frequent network, cutting frequencies from 15 to 20, is a particularly concerning kind of service cut if your goal is ridership. And I have said that.
That's our goal.
And I think that's really well established in the industry. I'll be happy to tell the story about Portland. I think Portland is a city that was thinking in the way that we recommend you think, which is they hit a horrific financial crisis in 2008. They had to take extremely steep cuts, and they did everything possible to protect the frequent network. They cut everything else they could cut before they cut frequencies below 15. Mm. When they finally had their backs against the wall and had nothing else to cut and had to cut those frequencies, they started cutting those frequencies from 15 to 17, and they got the biggest ridership drops in the history of the agency. Mm. Now, that may not happen here. That happened in the context of having a mature and already advertised frequent grid, where we had already been encouraging for many years riders to recognize this as a frequent and interdependent grid that really relied on those 15-minute headways. So and you start thinking about what happens. Okay, this route is still, these routes used to cross every 15 minutes, right? Now this is 15 and this is 17. So now suddenly it doesn't work the same way all day. Right, it works differently each time you do it. And how many people can remember a 17-minute frequency in their head? You know, 12 o'clock, 12:17, 12:34, 12:51, 1 whatever. You know, who can keep that in their heads? So we're pretty clear on why these very severe ridership losses occurred. And our transit agency in Portland, as the economy has come back, has made it an absolute top priority to get those frequencies back to 15. That seems to be the magic threshold. And I don't believe in magic. I think we can explain why it's a good threshold, because it's the point at which people start perceiving that the service is coming soon whenever they need it. And it's also a memorable number. You can keep the schedule in your head if it's 15, which you can when it's 17. So those are reasons to be generally concerned about cutting services out of the frequent network. And so where I want to go is more, how would the COA conversation have been different? How would the budgetary conversation have been different if you had had a policy frequent network that had been adopted by the city and PAG as, we're all committed to this? Well, then if 22nd had been in that network, and I'm not saying it would have been, but if it had been, then you wouldn't have considered a frequency cut to that as a way to solve that problem. Another thing that would have happened is that as the budget was being discussed at the city, there would have been a report to the council showing exactly what gets cut if they choose to do that, so that there was a clearer understanding of what that effect was. And that's generally how that would occur once you had a frequent network policy in place. But it's understandable that didn't happen. Now, you didn't have a policy in place when the
right.
budget rolled out.
Right.
Do you want to add to that, Karen?
Well, I think that's why that this process is so important, because I don't think that policymakers have had really any lens with which to make these decisions other than a very difficult budget lens. And I think staff has been given conflicting direction. Maintain coverage and frequency, without any way of helping them to understand what is our vision and priority. And if it's ridership, which is more tied to frequency, mm-hmm. that doesn't mean no tough choices. That means we'll hear from every neighborhood that used to have a bus going a little bit deeper in off the corridors, which now may have to walk out or bike out to those corridors. Do you see what I mean? So it is not going to be easier, regardless of what lens this process gives us, but it would give us a vision, and there would be justification and a sense, I think, in the community that we are shaping the transit system to serve the multimodal function it best serves. And then there are the other modes that help to fill out the map. Does that make sense, Brian? So, yeah, you know, it doesn't mean no changes. It doesn't mean even no cuts. But it does mean that what we do would make sense for the long term and for a smart, useful transit system. And I did want to tie back to some of the express routes very similarly. I don't know how that map was drawn. I wasn't involved at that time. But I think the assumption was there's a lot of commuters from the suburbs coming into downtown to work, which may be true. What also might be true is there's a whole lot more people in the urban core trying to get to jobs out in the fringes. And so what makes sense is that the route starts here and goes out instead of the opposite. Do you see what I mean? So again, I just don't know what lens we've been looking through or what analysis, but I think we better get clear before we do further damage to a system that's so important to the future. And that is what I think hopefully we will have for the entire region moving forward.
Well, it's about money, so couldn't Raytheon pay more for bringing their people in? Couldn't the U of A pay more for bringing their people
all
in, the county,
things,
et cetera, et cetera?
All of those things, I mean, they're immediate.
The port?
Right. There are immediate things we have to address, for sure. And we have to work toward, okay, how do we get out of this crisis mode which damages the system?
Thank you.
And in 10 years, will be irreparable to... How do we at least push out to a 2, 5, and 10-year lens, which means regardless of whether we're investing in the system or having to scale it back, which may happen sometimes, I've never been in favor of that because it's never made sense to me, but it may in the broader context of what we're dealing with, regardless of what changes are made, we know what to touch and what not to touch, right? So that's the goal.
Jeremy.
Yeah. So just one point of clarification. I don't want to turn this into a transit
task
force meeting that will be having on Tuesday, but I can't miss the opportunity to comment. And the minor service changes that we will be discussing are not to the frequent network as defined. We're talking about evening service on routes that are considered coverage routes, I think, by the definition that we're talking about here today. One, and number two, they are at 40-minute frequencies within a larger network of 60-minute frequencies during that time period. So I think that the discussion or the damage that I may do to ridership is very different than what Mr. Walker is speaking about to the frequent network. These are different types of routes that we'll be analyzing next week.
Great.
Yeah, and let me just make one more point about the RTA and our partnerships in the region, because this is so important. Whether it's John's question about the airport area or what we look at in terms of high capacity, high frequency moving forward. In the current RTA package, I for one thought, for example, when we say about 28% of the package right now is transit investment, are bus pullouts counted?
No.
Okay, so bus pullouts are counted as auto investment. Their safety. Okay. We just have to make sure. But it will help us when we look toward what infrastructure investment is needed for transit, that it actually is feeding into this vision. And a fear I had actually was that every bus pullout was regarded as part of our transit investment. It hurts transit. It slows frequency and efficiency.
Yes.
So not, I almost feel like we should have an offsetting column. How are we investing our resources in ways that undermine potentially? Again,
right on.
Just like with mayor right and council, on. And we're guilty of it as well. Guilty of it. We haven't had the lens that we need, and this is going to provide it. I have no doubt to get us all on the same page. I have no doubt.
So before we go, any other comments or questions from the table before we go to the comment cards?
I just had a little question about a combining of various high capacity. For example, I could see a streetcar extension to Elkhorn Mall. It's a great regional park and ride potential. And then having the higher capacity, higher speed toward the east.
Well, again,
a lot of opportunities for high capacity circulation within that corridor of Broadway.
Right. If you have people from the Far East trying to get downtown, bringing them to the streetcar, if the streetcar is like today's streetcar, means making them transfer to something that goes 6 miles an hour. They're not going to do it. You got to take them downtown. That's a the streetcar is just a fundamentally different thing. And, you know, if I'm pouring cold water on streetcar extensions, it's mostly just that I'm using the word extension very literally. I mean an extension off the end of the existing streetcar line. I don't mean a new streetcar line. Extending off the end of the existing streetcar lane means that more people traveling longer distances are going to be going 6 miles an hour through all those twists and turns. And I think that you're going to have difficulty making that attractive over a very much longer distance. But you know, there are all kinds of sort of hybrids between light rail and streetcar, and those words mean different things to different people. But generally, high capacity transit has to be optimized for travel over longer distances, which is why it has to be faster and more reliable, which is one of the reasons we come back down to exclusive lanes and other ways we protect it from traffic congestion. And that nobody can really avoid the fact that if you want to talk about HCT, you're going to be talking about that again. You're going to be talking about, at some point, you know, what you're prepared to do to protect this thing from congestion. Yes, Suzanne.
I will withdraw after this, but I just think it's a very important thing that you're discussing about the policy lens.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering from you, Councilmember Ulick, given that you're the only elected official from the city of Tucson in the room, and I do see Ward 1 staff here as well, do you have a plan or an idea for making sure that the rest of the mayor and council are actually using that lens or moving toward a point where they're going to be participating in this in a way that is productive?
Right on.
My sense is that it will be readily adopted, this lens. We have all been looking for a lens and recognize that it has been out of focus and pulled staff in several different directions. We know that. And so I genuinely believe that now, but I also believe that the truth is that lens will be used in times where we need to reduce transit investment, if that's ever a choice again, and I hope it isn't, but it may be, or if we have new money to invest. I also think the lens will help us make the case that we know how to invest more money for better impact, and we haven't had that case to make, quite frankly. So I see us tipping the scales toward more investment and strategic investment. And yes, I think this will be embraced. But that's not to say that right now the budget still is challenging to us, and cuts do come up from time to time, as you know. So
I think I'd like to, go ahead.
This idea of weekend service is fascinating where you're trying to induce it. Have you also looked at evening as well? We kind of have...
Yeah, we're standardizing extending the evening in Houston also to about a 19-hour service day. So generally kind of 5:30 to 12:30. And generally speaking, in that context where there's such an emphasis on this enormous service retail entertainment sector, really service entertainment sector, enormous numbers of people who are getting off at work at 10 or 11 p.m. and how they get home is a really important issue in Houston. And so we have standardized and extended that service day. We'll see what the payoff is. One of the things you have to remember about the frequent network is that one of the things that you commit to when you commit to a frequent network is that we're not going to take this apart hour by hour. Mm-hmm. We're not going to worry about what the ridership is between 10 p.m. and midnight. We know it's going to be low. But
we lose ridership early in the day because those people won't go to work if we can't get them home, right? So, and we create all sorts of other social problems of access to jobs, and you know, low-income people without cars lose their jobs because they can't get to them, and that has a direct consequence on you know, social service costs and a whole bunch of other outcomes for the community. So all that is tied to that position. I think of low ridership evening services as an important part of what's actually a total all-day offering. We don't analyze them trip by trip, right? So everybody knows, by the way, everybody who has ever done detailed transit service analysis knows that the ridership on the last trip of the day is always very low. And that if you cut that trip, the ridership then dies on the previous trip. And that's one of those basic dynamics that we see. Of course, nobody wants to be on the last trip. The last trip is everybody's insurance, and we invest in it as insurance fundamentally. We don't expect to use it, but we need it to be there. And I think that notion of insurance is the fundamental way to think about late evening service, despite the fact that when you look at it hour by hour, you wanted the ridership there. That's why the beginning of the frequent network is a fixed policy. This is going to run this number of hours a day at high frequency, and the whole network's going to run like that. And we've run the numbers, and we think we can afford that, and then we're not going to take it apart trip by trip. We're going to leave the whole thing in place, or we're going to cut an entire line out of it if we have to. But then there's the other thing, which is that you want to not commit to frequent lines whose permanence you're not pretty sure of, because you want land use events to respond to them. You want people to make location choices and respond to them, and you don't want to betray the people who've made those choices. And that's one of the main things that we get out of being more explicit about the frequent network. Yes, Jared?
Just that question of the all day. So are you saying that the frequent network would be, for example, if service starts normally at 6 a.m. and it ends at 11 p.m., the frequent network would be from 6 a.m. to 11 p.m.?
Generally speaking, you have a frequency commitment, and then you also have an evening service commitment that's less frequent. So there are two different commitments. There's a commitment that there will be at least half-hourly service, say, across a huge span, like 19 or 20 hours. And then there's a commitment that the frequency will be there over a somewhat shorter span, like maybe 15 or 16 hours, usually like 6 a.m. to 9 p.m. or something like that. It's hard to sustain the high frequency late into the evening. But you have to have service there late into the evening so everyone can get home. Yeah. I want to make one more comment before we throw it open. And that is, and I'm glad Brian joined us on this, because this is a really important thing for a lot of different, there are several different organizations represented around here. And what I want to say is, you all need your own view on the ridership coverage trade-off. Your organization needs its own view on what you're asking for when you ask for transit, if you're asking for transit. And I'm glad, you know, Mr. Moffitt gave us an excellent case study, which is this business park area south of the airport. That's going to expand demand for coverage service. What do you want? Do you want that to cause the ridership coverage split to move the other direction, which is what happens if the only transit expansions you make are those kinds of expansions? Mm-hmm. The percentage of the network that's focused to ridership goes this way. The bus riders union will itself need to have this policy, because the low-income people who are trying to get to those jobs on Alvernon are going to go to you, aren't they? And you're going to have a view about whether it's appropriate to send bus service out there as opposed to having more frequent bus service in the core. So every organization here needs to be forming its own view about that and framing your own transit needs, whatever you think transit should be doing, in terms of understanding how it moves that dial one way or another and therefore affects the total outcomes of the network. Make sense? So, yeah. So at this stage, why don't we go to the comment cards? Catherine, do you have them? We'll have another. And we have a podium right here. So I will go through these quickly. And most of these are it's great to have these questions. If you've asked a question that I think I can just answer, or that someone here can just answer, a factual question, I think we'll try to just answer it. If you're asking a broader thing, then we will call you up. So I have a question from Robin Steinberg. When the cuts were made in February, were they all frequency or were any of them coverage? Jared knows the answer to that question. I believe they were all frequency.
Primarily were frequency.
They were frequency cuts. The other part of her question is, could it have been done differently? Of course it could have been done differently. It depends on the direction.
Yeah, I would just like to add that there were frequency cuts done, but at the same time, we did increase frequency on some routes that were very important to us. So the Route 16 did move to 7 to 10-minute frequencies from 15-minute frequencies because we had some overcrowding issues. So, yeah, we tried to balance as much as possible to reallocate some of those resources, and the Transit Task Force did a very good job of helping us through that discussion as to what they were in support of in terms of adding a more frequency to routes that needed it. But in terms of realigning routes or taking them in different directions, most of the discussion in February was centered around frequency improvement.
Great. Barb?
There were other opportunities for change. But when we met with the Transit Task Force, the ones that were the type of the ones that they liked the best out of that group that we prevented.
So the Transit Task Force was involved in this conversation. That's important to note. The Transit Task Force needs a ridership coverage policy. They need to be, and I would encourage you as you're presenting ideas to them to be more explicit, to be very explicit about sort of which kind of change this is likely to be. Barbara Brookhart has an excellent question about Ronstadt. Barbara, do you want to come up to the podium, or shall I just take it from here? Which do you prefer? Okay. Barbara's question is, there's an ongoing RFP for the Ronstadt Transit Center. What are the requirements to have a multimodal transit center that will be adaptable for future needs? In other words, what need to be the transit demands and requirements on whatever gets built at Ronstadt? That's an excellent question. I think I want to encourage staff or electeds to respond to that. Jeremy, sorry.
I'm not specifically involved in the Ronstadt redevelopment evaluation process, but I can tell you that facility was funded with Federal Transit Administration funds, and as such, needs to be maintained as a transit asset to the community. And so, but in regards to the specifics of the current proposal, I don't know what levels are required, but I do know that it is required to be maintained as a transit asset and a transit center.
And just the explicit line drawn is no decrease in transit functionality. That's the line that was drawn in the process by mayor and council.
I know all of this.
Yeah.
What's the next? I want it to be an exciting multimodal transportation center. Public space.
Sure.
And all those things.
Yeah.
What is the state of art? Right. I want a state of art intermodal center. I've looked around and I haven't seen one.
Oh, so you want to know maybe what the best ones are that Jarrett has seen perhaps around the country and even around the world.
Okay, the state of the art for a transit center tends to be an urban transit center in the middle of a big downtown. So one of the challenges to think about is in planning Ronstadt, you've got to think about a bigger, denser, busier downtown than you currently have. Right? Because otherwise, an underscaled facility will actually be a constraint on that. It tends to have a climate-controlled interior waiting area that usually sits on the ground floor surrounded by bus bays. And the typical experience is that you're in this climate-controlled waiting area. There is each of the bus bays has a door. That door opens when the bus is there. It minimizes loss of air conditioning. And you interact with that bus only when the door is open. The other thing that does is it keeps all the bus emissions largely out of the place where people are waiting. That then becomes an interior room which has all sorts of obvious commercial and vending opportunities and which can then have a connection to an upper floor. This thing's usually then on the lowest floor of some kind of building where there can be other kinds of facilities that are useful. I think the downtown plaza in Spokane, Washington is a pretty good example. It's not the best. The facility I'm describing to you is very common in Australia and New Zealand, and a little bit harder to get funded here. But that's obviously what you really want. You do have to be thinking about what kind of climate experience you want. Ronstadt right now is basically an open-air facility, so it's 120 degrees there right now or whatever it is. And that's an important part of how that affects the future transit offering. But generally speaking, when you've in communities where a large diversity of people rides the bus, you have a climate-controlled waiting area, and there are a couple of ways it can work. One is that you have a, what happens in Spokane, for example, is that you have a climate-controlled waiting area, and there's an airport-style monitor. And the airport-style monitor says the number 7 bus will be at Bay 2 in 3 minutes. And when it's 1 minute, you all go out to Bay 2. And it's 110 degrees there, but you're only there for a minute. And then they get on the bus. That's one low-tech solution to that. Another solution is more the sophisticated thing where you have the door that opens just when the bus is there. Those are some standard things. Obviously, that can be part of the ground floor of a building of any size, which can... But the first 2 floors of that need to be, the ground floor facility needs to have appropriate design that makes that a welcoming space and a place where lots of different people feel comfortable. And usually there's a relationship to second floor retail that is also relevant to the transit customer and is readily available. Those are some of the standard things. Let me make one observation about capacity at Ronstadt. The current number of bays, I'm guessing, is probably going to do fine well into the future for this reason. As we turn up frequencies, you actually have less need for lots of buses to be there at the same time. And we tend to get higher bay turnover and better utilization. So I don't know, so I wouldn't say that just because we have a vision of the transit system getting bigger, Ronstadt necessarily needs to get bigger in terms of bay capacity. It will have an increasing need. Buses will need to be able to terminate there, and bus drivers will be taking breaks. That tends to happen away from the main facility. There will be more and more of that, but it doesn't necessarily mean that it needs to grow into 30 bays or whatever just because we're growing the system that large. It can be reasonably compact, and there's pretty good experience on how to do that if it's important. What matters is whether it's whether there's a decision that it's important to get that right. So, Camille. Keichner has a question about park and rides and their contribution to the high frequency network and weekday and evening service. Camille, do you want to come up or shall we just answer it from here? Okay. Okay. So park and ride is a great tool for enabling, the basic purpose of park and ride is so that people who are not near good service can get to good service and use it. And one of the things Park and Ride can do is release the pressure on us to offer lots of coverage service in lower density areas where we know that that coverage service is not going to get very many riders. Park and Ride becomes one way to say to those parts of the city, look, we are still serving you. You just do still get a benefit from transit. It lies in this Park and Ride. In the long run, Park and Ride has, in the very long run, Park and Ride has some downsides, which are that eventually high quality transit starts to raise land value because the land is valuable because the access is good, but free parking is contingent on low land value, right? A surface parking lot is something that happens when the land value is low. They all get built on when the land value is high. So in bigger cities, we have these conflicts about, yes, we've had a surface parking lot there for 25 years, but now the market wants to build, a huge town center. That parking lot is no longer the highest and best use for that land. And what's more, all the demand from the town center that's going to be built is more ridership than has ever come out of that parking lot. Mm-hmm. And so at a big city stage, which I think you're not near yet, you start to get those issues. But you should be cautious about creating park and rides in places where land value is already high or where there's a lot of development interest, because you may get that conflict down the line. There's a lot of great things that can be done too with what's called casual park and ride. Houses of worship have always been an obvious example. Cinemas are another. Private facilities whose parking demand peaks on the evening and weekend and never during the commute day. Those places basically have parking lots sitting open the whole commute day. And there's long been a series of relationships between transit agencies and those organizations to use those as parking rides. In Utah, for example, where one organization controls the vast majority of church parking lots in the state, the Mormon Church, it was a very high level decision. The Utah Transit Authority got together with the Mormon planners, and they made a deal about every park and ride at every church.
And it's a pretty important part of how people get around informally. So you don't have to build a big facility, is the point. You get a lot done with spare parking. You know, there will also, by the way, be a phenomenon called hide and ride, which is where people just park on the street near the bus stop. And that doesn't become a problem until the neighborhood decides it's a problem. A certain stage is just another good opportunity. I have a, from Rod, I can't quite read his last name. It starts with an S.
Spark.
Private-public partnership funding of high-capacity transit, parentheses, streetcar. Rob, you want to come up and expand on that? If not, we can talk a little bit. Come up to the podium, if you would, because there's a microphone there, a passive microphone, so that the
I'd like to echo what Bob said. Thank you so much. I think it's really helped us. I think part of the paradigm shift that will occur in our community, but we're all looking at high-capacity transit as a way of changing the life quality of life here. But it's clear that from general funding sources, we're really limited. We're always trading off. Having some kind of independent funding source seems to be the obvious solution. And one of the things that I think is being considered is a private-public partnership or private funding models to accomplish this. I wondered if you have some comments or experience, and many municipalities or transit authorities are facing the same, ceiling. And that's what I was.
There are several different things that could, why don't you stay up, because you may have answers to. There's a couple different things that could mean. That could mean that the private sector is involved, has made some financial investment in the line that they're going to recoup in like fare revenue from the line. That's one model. One of the downsides of that, which I've experienced in several models like this, most recently a subway line in Vancouver, is that you have to construct those arrangements very carefully because you're at risk of getting all of the private sector tends to expect secrecy, and secrecy is toxic to a community planning process. So that's the one caution about that model, which is that, you know, I remember this subway project in Vancouver. There have been lots of, and when I worked, this happens a lot in Australia and New Zealand. There just isn't very much public consultation because the private partner wants to be so secretive. And that's a standard private sector behavior. And not, they're not doing anything wrong. It's just what it means to deal with private companies. And so that has to be worked through very carefully. It can work, but the deal between the government and the private sector has to be very clear about what's going to be public information and what the public's going to be allowed to talk and be allowed to know. The other kind of public-private partnership is a lot of how streetcars are being built. And that is really the financial interest of people of landowners who are going to profit from the developability of their land, hitting up those people fundamentally in advance.
Amen.
To pay for the line. And that is frankly how a lot of the American streetcar projects have happened. That is pretty normal. And I think what we're talking about in the context of high capacity transit, it ought to be possible there too, because high capacity transit has some of the same impacts. It might affect your rail versus bus decision. You know, if the private money really thinks it needs to be rail and they want to come up with the money that makes it rail, there are ways to figure that out. I think that concept is in its infancy. It's not really how the current federal funding system is designed to work, but I think under the new financial realities, you're going to see more and more demands for that, and I think that's going to be an interesting option for a lot of transit agencies going forward. If you want to research this, the technical term for that is called value capture. In other words, capturing some of the land value that is going to be created by this project. And let's remember, of course, that's how all of the early 20th century tram systems were built. They were actually built by the developers who were going to sell real estate along them. And so, you know, there is an important history of that, and we may go back to that direction. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
That leaves, I think, Colby Henley, and I would like to ask Colby to come up and state his.
So my question is regarding, there's been a fair bit of talk today about a 10-year and 20-year, kind of a more detailed transit vision and focusing that plan. So I was part of the Citizens Task Force, and part of the Citizens Task Force for the Broadway corridor, and we've spoken to that need multiple times about the need to do kind of that detailed transit study and stuff. And so I'm curious from Karen and RTA PAG folks, where in the process is there funding identified to do that? Is there a vision to do that? Just curious kind of where we stand with doing it, not just for Broadway, but for the community as a whole.
I'll just touch on that. Yes, the short answer is yes. And the timing, obviously, we're going to start the process of developing the scope of work and go through a RFP process. So we hope to have something completed within the next 2 years.
Great. Thank you.
So we're at 11:15. We have another 15 minutes. Let me ask again if anyone else at the table wants to say anything or make any comments about what we've said. Yes.
I have a question. My name is Laura Den. I'm here on behalf of Councilmember Romero at the city, and I think Karen's comments were great about kind of developing this lens and trying to make sure that we're all working from the same mindset when we're looking at how we prioritize and make transit decisions. And I'm just wondering, process-wise, what have you seen that has been effective in other communities so that we're hearing from the Bus Riders Union, we're hearing from transit advocates, from the business community, to see what the priorities are so that the council can help shape that vision?
Right. Well, it depends a lot on, well, let me put it this way. The process by which all the elected boards ultimately come to be engaged in this process is very much driven by their constituents, by the folks in the room, by the organizations they represent. And I think what we've had in Tucson has been a reasonably routine process, which is that we run a stakeholder workshop. The people who are interested come. That produces a lot of great stuff. It stimulates a lot of good ideas. We report back on it. And that goes out in the community. People talk about it. They start reacting to the maps. And next thing you know, it's time to do another stakeholder workshop, and now a lot more people are interested, and we start getting even more of the community represented. You know, I ultimately want to get to, you want to get to a stakeholder workshop where your Tea Party patriots are at the table too, where you really have the whole diversity of the community, and you've got the whole diversity of what people think about transit, and you're really together and solving the problem. I tend to find that the basic stakeholder workshop structure that we went through in April works really well, but may need to be done several times. And each time you do it, you get greater understanding, greater buy-in, and more people understanding what the actual questions are they have to answer, like the ridership coverage question. You have to answer that question, or you have not given clear direction, right? That's the message. And as more and more people come to understand that, it helps them to form and think about what they're doing. Helps to create reasonable expectations for, say, what a suburban business park might expect when it chooses to develop in a particular place, what another development. And that is what ultimately leads toward some kind of action or process. So in Raleigh, North Carolina, for example, where there's a much more explicit deadline to actually put an expenditure plan on the ballot, we did a similar kind of workshop. We had 70 people there, and they were really representing the whole diversity of the city. And so it was the same basic process. So it's not unusual to have to do that several times. Fundamentally, until we have the conversation happening among the people who will actually need to make the decisions and informed by a much larger number of people who care about what they do and are writing to them, you know, wanting to have an influence.
One more.
I have a comment from David Carranza in the city of South Tucson. He has given me a map. And why don't... the map appears to have a streetcar on South Avenue and something called on 6th Avenue and something called a trolley on 4th Avenue and HCT a little east of 4th Avenue. So why don't you tell us a bit about that?
When I was listening to everyone, David Carranza, City of South Tucson, we do have a kind of a vision in the City of South Tucson. Thanks to Benny and all the staff and myself. We also put together an economic plan. But one of the things we came up with is 6th Avenue is very busy. It's extremely busy, and we think that with PAG, they already have the streetcar coming down 6th. We also have the notion of the trolley coming down 4th as one or two options, and then we also have the train tracks that just east of us as HCT possibility. I wanted you to elaborate on that a little more, because I think those are three viable options for the city of South Tucson mm-hmm. when it comes to economic development.
Right. One of the, because transit needs to be linear,
it is linear.
Yes, it is. Because transit needs to be linear, one of the things that, and as the development community starts figuring this out, they start looking for development opportunities that are between other big transit destinations and right on the way between them, because that is the best way to make sure you're going to have good transit. And the city of South Tucson's in exactly that position. Because you are on the way between Tucson and Laos and everywhere people get to from Laos, you are in an excellent position to not only have good transit over the years, but to be able to, you know, achieve all kinds of other economic benefits out of that. South 6th Avenue is the busiest transit corridor in the city. It's supporting the highest frequencies right now, a bus about every 7 minutes. As you look at HCT alternatives, one of the interesting trade-offs you've raised is that you can go look at the rail line, but your city is already built around those high-volume streets to a great extent, and that that'll become an interesting conversation within your city about, do we really focus on where people are now or on a vision of what might be over here in the future? So I would expect some people in your city to probably be against the HCT line over on the rail line, because 6th is where things are happening now, right? So that'll be some of the conversation inside your city that you folks will probably have. It's difficult to imagine a better transit street than South 6th. It's just terrific. And there's so much potential there, and so much potential to continue build on the frequency that's there. But what you remember, the bus service there is really good, so you have to design an HCT system that's better than that. And that rules out a few things, right? You got a bus every 7 minutes. If you replace that with an HCT that comes every 20 minutes, your customers are going to perceive that as a service cut. Mm-hmm. It's got to be really intensive to be better than the bus that's already there. Huh. So it's going to be an interesting task, but that's a reason I would caution you about using the word streetcar for it, because it needs to be faster than the streetcar people know today. And to the it depends on what people mean by that word. If many people in Tucson hear the word streetcar and they visualize, you know, scenic, pleasant, 6 miles an hour, not something I'd go any distance on. That's what you need on South 6th is fundamentally different, because this is how people get from Tucson, from other parts of Tucson, not just to Laos, but to everywhere beyond Laos, the business park, you know, the business parks, the airport, and so on. Calle Santa Cruz, so much is going to feed into that. So congratulations for being in a great geographical situation. This is one of those, it's an important parable. You know, you can mention South Tucson.
I think the mayor thanks you as well.
Because please remember, a lot of our ordinary constituents who don't think about transit much are going to assume that their transit service is some expression of the government's opinion about them, about who they are. It's not. Your transit service is a fact about where you are. If a city that looked exactly like Tucson, a city looking exactly like Tucson, like South Tucson, that square mile with that same number of people in exactly that configuration were moved out beyond Tucson Mountain, it would support a whole lot less transit service than it has because of where it is, right? Your geography is your destiny, and this is why the future of transit always lies in helping people make responsible choices about where to locate, and helping everyone, institutions, organizations, and individuals, to accept the responsibility for the consequences of their own location choice. So locate in South Tucson and not out by Tucson Mountain if you want good transit service, right? Mm. Because you're not going to have good transit service out there. It's too much empty space on the way for the near future, and that's going to be the basic reality of what high ridership networks do. So everything we can do to help people, and I understand that there's an issue for some low-income people who don't feel like they chose their location or who don't feel like they have any freedom, but there's an issue for the service organizations, for the planners of low-income facilities, right, to not put those things in places where people can't get to it. But that fundamental responsibility, you know, this is, you can present this in totally conservative terms, folks. This is freedom and personal responsibility. People choose their location choices. Businesses choose their location choices. These things have consequences.
and they have clear transit consequences based on whether they add up to the kind of land use pattern where transit succeeds or not. And so that's a fundamental sort of consciousness-raising process that needs to be going all the time, wherever you are. So any other comments or questions? Did you want to make closing remarks, Commissioner?
Just thank you very much. Let's give Jarrett Walker a round of applause. Well, I'm very pleased, and also want to thank Farhad and the RTA PAG. Important leadership, important partners. So thank you so much.
And I want to thank all of you. Again, I get to leave town. This isn't about me. This is about what you decide to do coming out of this meeting is what matters. So thanks very much, everyone. Give yourselves a round of applause.
Good work, Matt. Thank you.